My name is Susan, and I am here to present Nick Van Woert on behalf of the sculpture department. Van Woert was born in Reno, Nevada, and has lived in Brooklyn for the last 12 years. He comes from a family of creatives. He grew up drawing and studied architecture at the University of Oregon and received an MFA at Parsons in New York. Van Woert has had two solo museum exhibitions, Violence at GEM, the Museum of Contemporary Arts in The Hague, Netherlands, in 2016, and Nature Calls at MAMbo, the Museum of Modern Art in Bologna, Italy, in 2014. Solo gallery exhibitions include Yvon Lambert in Paris and New York, GRIMM Gallery in Amsterdam, L&M in Los Angeles, Moran Bondaroff in Los Angeles. Upcoming exhibitions include GRIMM Gallery New York in June, Patron Gallery Chicago in September 2017. Please help me welcome Nick.
Hi, everybody. I got a lot of pictures to show you, so we'll just get into it, but thanks for having me out. Saw a bunch of cool stuff today. My name is Nick. I'm from Reno, Nevada. I don't know, I didn't think Reno had much to do with the work that I make until I think after I left. It's kind of this high desert landscape where everything is very exposed. You see how, I don't know, material deteriorates and how it's grown or decays, and then that's like the natural landscape, and then the urban landscape that kind of butts up against it has this kind of artificial quality to it. Like, gambling is legal, so there's all the certain kind of lifestyle that I guess the architecture and the the architecture promotes in a way. So it has this kind of very vibrant colors that come out at night. And for me, I started to make these connections later on in my life. Part of it is that I kind of consider myself a landscape painter now. I ended up making this artwork that was totally in these two genres of the most uncool forms of making artwork now, which is like figurative sculpture or figurative work and landscape painting. But we'll get to that later. I went to undergrad in architecture and didn't really catch any of the art historical stuff. It kind of came to me later. This is a famous painting by Albert Bierstadt, who kind of is known for painting America and the American West. This is a painting of Donner Lake, which I grew up like 30 minutes away from here. And it became strange to me because I grew up in this place, like rock climbing and mountain biking, snowboarding or whatever. And there's certain things about this painting that are recognizable, but at the same time, it's a completely different place now. Like, the material has changed and it's just it exists in the kind of altered state right now. But I think you can see in this painting that it has a certain similarity in terms of color to like this artificial quality of this new landscape that we kind of live in now. This is a guy from ancient Roman culture called an agrimensor. He was like a land surveyor, and I was reading all about this stuff for some show I did a long time ago because I felt like the Roman culture was like at the nucleus of the way we live now and like how they built cities and kind of understood the natural environment. And this was a tool that they would use called a groma that I think reoccurs in my work every now and then, and they would use it to lay down a grid over the natural landscape as a way of kind of rationalize it, and they would build streets according to these straight lines that gave them the ability to draw, and buildings as well. And then these are just some of the influences that I've had over the years. This is a book by Edward Albee called The Monkey Wrench Gang. It was a fictional book, and it was about this group of individuals who kind of gathered together to preserve what we have left of the American West. So, like, in the opening chapter, they burn a billboard down and they'll like tree spike. The whole book is about kind of trying to blow this dam up, but they'll, I don't know, it's actually a pretty funny book, but it served as like the real kind of manifesto or Bible for Earth First, which is a real kind of eco-terrorist group. And when they announced their existence, which I think it was probably in either late 60s or early 70s, they went to Glen Canyon Dam, which is kind of the main character in that book, and threw this giant vinyl wedge off of the face of it to signify this crack running down the surface of it. And for me, like, there's something about this image that's very striking, and the action that they took seemed like to relate to art or sculpture or photography, like, in a very clear way. And this guy, Dave Foreman, who was one of the founders of Earth First, wrote this book called A Field Guide to Monkey Wrenching, and it's like a real home economics course in like blowing stuff up. And so they had this crazy relationship to kind of ordinary materials that I thought was more interesting than anything I was seeing in the artists were doing, I guess. They had this kind of, I don't know, unconventional way of approaching materials, which I think most artists kind of look for. And throughout this whole book, they have like, I don't know, we'll go get into some of the works, but in the fictional book, Monkey Wrench Bang, the gang, they burn this billboard down that says, "We're all in this together." And then in the, which is what this thing says. And then in the corner, there's these two kind of vitrines, one filled with chlorine and one filled with hair gel. And in the Field Guide to Monkey Wrenching, there's on the chapter on how to burn a billboard down, they like have an envelope. I think at the time, the billboard structures were made out of wood. So what they would do is get a can of gasoline, pour it at the base of these structures, and then they'd get this envelope, which on one side had hair gel and on the other side chlorine, and they'd keep it folded so they didn't touch, pour the gas, unfold it, and kind of mash it together, and then toss it on the puddle, and they'd have like 5 to 10 minutes before this chemical reaction between the hair gel and the chlorine got hot enough to catch the gas on fire. And so it acted like a fuse, and they would joke that they'd be at the bar having drinks by the time this thing went up in flames. And so for me, it had an impact on me seeing this, because these were like two materials that I think come from a very specific lifestyle. There's like hair gel, which is about kind of maybe vanity or looking fresh or fashion or whatever you want to call it. And then there's chlorine, which is for your swimming pool, which is about like leisure, maybe wealth, like free time and vacation. These are two things I think that are like maybe very American, but they're very specific in terms of lifestyle and maybe class and stuff like that. And for me, they're two materials that I think provide a certain amount of comfort for us, in terms of color, in terms of just what they're used for. But when they're mixed together, like, it's absolute chaos and kind of poisonous, or what chlorine is like one of the most poisonous materials we have. And so what I started to see or realize is that the comfort that these materials provide is just camouflage for the kind of chaos underneath. And so there's been a number of these billboard things that have been made. I'm not going to talk about all of them. And then, so this kind of new perception of the materials that I'm kind of surrounded by, evolved into what I consider a kind of landscape painting, which is what these things are. And so, first when I tried to use hair gel and chlorine, I wanted to cast with it, and I was mixing it with this resin, and I was leaving the studio one night and like mixed up a tiny cup, and I used this like two-part urethane mixture that gets real hot when it starts to set. And so I had like a tiny little plastic cup with a little bit of chlorine in it, and like mixed it up, and it gets real hot within like 5 minutes. And so I was like ready to leave. I was like, you know, they use this to start fires and whatnot. So I was like, I'll put it on a piece of concrete just in case, you know, this little thing catches on fire, it won't burn the place down. But I walk like 10 feet towards the door, and this little cup just starts pumping smoke out of the top of it. And so I run outside, throw it in the snow, and look back in the studio, and there's like a foot of smoke just lining the whole ceiling of the studio. And I look back outside, and it's still just pumping smoke up the side of the building. And I'm like trying to Google on my phone at the same time the like problems with chlorine smoke, and it's like blindness, like you're gonna die. And so I grabbed a shovel, tried to put this thing out, finally put it out, was like freaking out, looking at the studio like I gotta get out of here. And then I hear fire trucks in the distance, and I'm just like, holy shit. So shut the lights off, lock the door, and I start to leave, and I'm like, this is just, if they do come here, they're gonna cut down every door in the building until they find out where this is coming from. And so I figured I should stay, let them in if they need to get in, and do what they need to do. And then finally the truck comes and it just keeps driving by, and it wasn't a big deal. I just locked up and left after that. But anyway, I needed to figure out a way to get these materials to exist in the same place at the same time without killing anyone. And so I wanted to retain, all of them have this kind of natural quality to them. Like chlorine kind of looks like this dirt or sand. It almost looks real, even though it's like a completely, I don't know, maybe orphan material. It's just kind of a chemical concoction. And so I started using these plexiglass boxes. And so this one, for example, I almost used the grocery store as like a quarry. There's another story I'll get to that kind of help explain some of this stuff. But this one is like BioDrain grease and waste digester. There's like Zep glass cleaner, Mr. Clean, Kool-Aid, which is a material that also has a kind of dark history with the Jonestown massacre. And so sweet like candy, but I don't know. A lot of these things I think have this kind of dark history that, or a kind of poisonous quality to them that I started to see as, I don't know, everywhere. But I guess there's more to that, whatever. Adhesive, pine glow, chlorine, Dunkin' Donuts, Brillo board, hair gel, highway glass spheres, plastic flowers, pine sol, lotion hand soap, stuff like that. So they're kind of made out of the stuff that I see and touch every day in some form or another. And if you just Google landscape painting, you can see the kind of similarity in the colors. And so I felt like these sculptures had this kind of connection to the history of landscape painting in terms of color, but kind of marked this shift in the landscape in terms of their material. Like it's just not what it was. And then there's other ones that are kind of more site-specific. There was a show at the Nevada Museum of Art, and so went out there and like collected all this material kind of from that area and just stacked it up. And for me, like the stacking is kind of reflective of like strata. Like if you were to cut a cross section through the earth, you get this kind of layering of materials. And so, and also this kind of log cabin kind of thing, that kind of structure that is like a symbol for American freedom and, I don't know, a form of the American dream maybe. It's not super important to me that that stuff is apparent, but I think it's kind of buried in there. So some of these materials, it's just like Kool-Aid, muscle milk, like stuff you can almost get anywhere but is everywhere, and stuff that's kind of unique to the area, like the chainsaw bear and like Lake Tahoe stickers and just whatever. And one interesting thing I think that came out of this was like the, I don't know what you could say. I feel like the materials that we use to make things act like a lens or like a filter on a camera, like it changes your perception and your understanding of the world around you. There's those kind of famous Mel Bochner pieces where he just goes into the room or gallery and marks the dimensions. And I think part of his thought was that, or you could almost take those dimensions and divide it by 48 inches, because 48 inches is the standard unit for building. That's like a sheet of plywood. You have 8-foot ceilings because a sheet of plywood is 8 feet tall. And then 4 feet wide, you could probably divide this room up into 4-foot increments evenly, because it's cheaper and faster if you don't throw away any material and you don't waste your time cutting it. And so we'll build within these kind of arbitrary limitations of a standardized material, and the they kind of guide our perception and influence our perception, I think, of the world around us. And so these materials, I think, do exactly the same thing. So with this one, for example, to try to make it explicit, this is like looking through one of those stacked material pieces, and this is basically hair gel vision. So you can like look through it, and it acts like a filter on the camera again, where it changes the way everything looks. Like this is pine saw and, I don't know, some kind of floor cleaner or something like that. This is a Thomas Cole painting. It was like a part of a series of paintings called Course of Empire, which is kind of about the rise and fall of a civilization. And there was a piece with the same title that was a kind of labyrinth that related to, what's his name? Starts with a B. Borges. Anyway. Let's see. At the same time, I think this comes up later, but when I had been reading about the kind of ancient Roman culture and whatnot, there's a number of weird things you'll find, and one of them was this character called the Haruspex, and the Haruspex was like a kind of, almost like a fortune teller, kind of soothsayer, but what they would do is that whenever they were interested in setting up a new camp during warfare or building a new city, they would send this guy out and he would collect animals from that particular site and he would dissect them and inspect their entrails, and if the entrails were healthy, then the land was deemed healthy and capable of sustaining a healthy life. And so there was this kind of empirical logic in place where you are what you eat, you are a direct reflection of the environment that you inhabit. And if, I don't know, I just thought it was interesting. It's one thing to think about it in a natural landscape where you're eating berries or nuts or grasses, and if that's bad, then you're gonna be unhealthy or whatever. But for me, it was more interesting to kind of put that into a man-made environment and just look at the city I live in through this kind of lens, where if you take the kind of architectural ingredients or just whatever it is, like using the grocery store as a quarry, like all of those materials are in a way, according to this logic, like a reflection of me. If you look at a building, it becomes a kind of figurative sculpture in a way, and a reflection of you. And so that brought in this kind of anatomical, I don't know, angle to the way I was looking at material in a sense. So if you were to cut through a building, it's the same as almost like cutting through a body. But I only bring that up because that particular piece was called Anatomy. These were some more kind of direct landscape paintings that came after those plexi boxes. I think the main purpose of these was just to kind of make a more direct connection to the tradition of painting. So like the blue in this one is a type of cat litter. I think the one on the right is probably coal slag or something like that. And while these are being made, I had this whole list of materials going where I became kind of interested in all the artificial materials that we've kind of recreated as substitutes for natural ones. So cat litter equals dirt, like Coca-Cola equals water. I don't know, the list goes on, styrofoam, whatnot. And these were the first cat litter ones. And so I made this maybe corny connection between, I got into how we have made walls over the centuries or whatever it is. And so I think we started with maybe caves, and then it turned to bricks, and then it turned to whatever, wood, and then maybe whatever. So if I follow this logic and like cat litter equals dirt, then we could, and maybe there's a time when we start doing that. And so this is like cat litter blobs, CNC routed to look like vinyl siding, and they just have titles that are the name of the cat litter I use. So Everclean, I don't know what that one was, but just those fresh expressions. They're kind of corny, but so I guess part of what I'd been interested in is this kind of, well, the landscape and how we've approached it, the mark we leave on it, and just, I don't know, how we deal with it or rewrite it. This was one that was cast bark, and then anytime anyone came to the studio, they could like carve something into it. Satan, Slayer, Save Some Whale, Hi Mom, whatever. Yeah. These is cat litter, vinyl siding, and then like a joint compound. I don't know if I want to talk about all these. This one is a recreation of a billboard, or not a billboard, a pushpin board in Yosemite Valley. It's kind of a famous campground called Camp 4, and people will post all kinds of notes on it, and they typically have to relate to, I don't know, well, climbing or travel or something, and like trading certain things or favors or whatever to get outside, get rides to wherever, go climbing and or campsites or whatever. And I felt like it had a kind of connection to carving in the tree. I don't know, let's see. This was a part of that. The whole show kind of revolved around those artificial materials, and this piece was called Coral Reefer. It's made out of aquarium rocks, and it has this kind of, I guess at the time I'd been thinking about the desire, like why we create these materials. We're not running out of dirt. We're not running out of trees. It's just it's a planet made of rock and wood and all these natural materials. But I started to think that the desire to kind of do this is, it like paralleled our desire for immortality. And if we can make a material that will last forever, like a plastic or whatever, then we too maybe can do that for ourselves, or maybe live through that material, or it's this kind of constant manipulation of something in an attempt for immortality. And so it has this eternal flame coming out of this lighter that runs off of a propane tank. And I think like the other thing, like using those materials, it's like I feel like I'm kind of totally sober walking around in an intoxicated landscape, and so nothing is what it seems and everything exists in this kind of altered state. Like the coral or the aquarium rocks are like a stand-in for the kind of beauty and mystery of the ocean floor or like subterranean life. And I don't know, it's just weird. I guess coming from architecture too, when I went, it was about this full-on modernist mentality, which I fully kind of embrace aspects of it today, which is all about this truth to material. Don't like make things that masquerade as something they are not. And I kind of like believe in that, but I like applying it, I guess, to these materials that are like you have no idea what they are. This is another one called beer. So there's a few, they were all going to have like different, whether it's weed or beer or these kind of references to drugs in a sense, because those alter your perception of the way the world is. This was the first piece called Haruspex, which was that figure I was talking about. It's a found classical statue that I just had smashed in half. And my studio at the time was like a subterranean studio, and so every day there was like a new pile of trash out in the doorway, whether it was like chip bags, Monster energy drinks, glass, bricks, asphalt, Mad Dog 40 bottles, like you name it, it was kind of out there. And so I took a plastic bag and just kind of jammed it down the torso and kind of propped it, the top of it up with some 2x4s. And then each day I would gather the new material out there, put it in the bag, put a little bit of resin in to kind of solidify it, and then, you know, it's set up. And then you couldn't see what was happening on the inside because it was just a black garbage bag. And then after, like, I don't know, a week or more of doing that, peeled the bag off and had this kind of weird land-looking form and this kind of layers of material. This came before all those plexiglass pieces. But for me, it was more about seeing this direct relationship as, like, the guts of the city were now the guts of this figure. And just to kind of hit that head on and squarely was, I don't know, important to me. And that's what this piece, like, set me off down that path of making landscape paintings or working within that tradition and then seeing them as figurative pieces as well. This was called horror vacui, which is a term that in science, I think it's the idea that a vacuum can't really exist. And so if there is an empty space, it will be filled with a gas or some, like anything, a liquid or whatever it is. It basically is saying that a void cannot really exist. And in art, it's typically a term to describe, I don't know, a drawing or an etching where every like, there's no white space left. Every square inch of the surface is covered with some kind of mark left by the artist. And so it's made out of a like urethane material that has built into its kind of chemical structure that if it's exposed to water, it literally expands. And so got this kind of classical statue and just hung it from the ceiling and would apply this material again and again on it. And part of the kind of nature aspect that I have been fascinated with forever is like how things grow in nature. And part of what I don't like participating in with my work is like conversations around proportion and composition and all this stuff that seems arbitrary and meaningless. And with this, like the way an icicle is formed, it's like the result of a million different uncontrollable forces. And you have a certain trust for the shape or the beauty of an icicle because you know it couldn't have been done in any other way. And so for me, it came down to like, I think what it was is this kind of fascination with the things that exist but were not made. Like all of the things that exist but were not made, I think that's what we consider to be nature. And if you can get your work to like fall into that category, it will have this kind of, it can be completely grotesque and it can be beautiful and it will be highly respected in a sense. At least for me, like when I see stuff like that, you just have this kind of gut reaction or gut feeling that you have this knowledge that it is just kind of a perfect thing in a sense because it is the result of so many uncontrollable forces and it has like a, it becomes a kind of reflection of the place it exists in. And so this is kind of a process, I guess, that reflected that, at least to me. And then at the same time kind of reflected the, I don't know, intentions or motivations of the culture I live in, which is like if there's an empty space, we'll fill it. These were some busts that were made and then kind of cut up into pieces and rewelded more or less inside out. Let's see. These ones kind of relate to what I was talking about earlier about the 48 inches, and what they are is architectural templates that have been enlarged to 48 inches wide. And I mean, the template itself is about reproducing a standardized form. And what I would do with these is typically apply some material that seemed to fall into that same kind of standardized category. But I think the thought in it is like standardized form, standardized materials, you end up with a kind of standardized life. And this has an image of the ego, the Pruitt Ego housing complex on it, which they always talk about it in architecture school as this kind of symbol for modernism. And it was built as like a low income housing project that was meant to kind of solve issues of poverty and community and all that. And it just turned into an absolute failure. And they ended up demolishing, I don't think they demolished all of them, but a number of them. And it marked this moment in time that was like the end of this modernist dream of like utopia and perfection through architecture. And it was like a kind of prefab style housing structure. This one is called Cold Cut, and I think that it was about like making a connection between lunch meat and modern architecture. These were ones that were like cut out of corion, which is a kind of contemporary formica. Formica is one of those materials that coats every kitchen from the like 70s. And it comes in any kind of faux finish you want. It can come in solid colors. It can look like wood. It can look like granite. It can look like whatever you want. It's like a perfect masquerade. And corion is kind of the new version of that. And for me, it was this, take these architectural templates, and then they were distorted, just to kind of talk about that, reference the altered states and the intoxicated landscape. This one was my studio at the time. It was that subterranean studio, and this was, I guess, I got broken into a couple of times, and I think an artist studio is probably a weird place to break into if you're looking for something valuable, because I think with art, the value structure is like flipped. The art is probably the most expensive thing in there, but it has like absolutely no value for someone probably breaking in. But this is like a copy of the window that he broke to get into the studio. And so it was like a double pane kind of plexiglass window that he'd smashed through and crawled through. And for me, I mean, the studio is kind of a reflection of what's going on in your mind, and trying to imagine this guy like breaking into my head and like rummaging around and wondering what the hell this place was and maybe stealing some tools and then leaving. It just seemed really, I don't know, strange to me. And I think that the way in which he kind of ransacked, I don't know, my head in a way was similar to the way I'd like to be able to ransack, I don't know, the culture I'm involved in, to kind of, I don't know, this kind of breaking and entering mentality seemed to kind of make sense to me. And I liked how he, in a way, made this sculpture for me. This is the guy they thought it was. The portrait of the artist. I think one of the reoccurring things that comes up is this kind of half natural, half human, I don't know, form or whatever. I think, I don't know, I just like making those things, and it's kind of like this desire for myself to kind of wonder what life would be like. It's like a Thoreau quote where he wonders what, like, the whole idea, I think, of living is to try to live the most real life possible, and for him it was like trying to see what life would have to offer if you strip away all the modern amenities that we have now and see what it was, to see if it would be a life worth living or brutal or whatever it would be. And so I always think about that. And a lot of this stuff that's like half natural, half man, I think is a kind of representation of that thought. Like these are kind of figurative sculptures where it's a fiberglass statue that was kind of cut into three pieces, and then these coal slag rocks were basically built up around them. So you have like, I don't know if the feet, the legs, the torso, and then there was a head that went into a different spot. But as if they were these kind of archaeological things dug up, and like you're looking at the inside of this statue to kind of build this story about whoever these people may have been or whatever these things were. This is a cat litter surveyor. The Rembrandt painting, this goes back to the kind of archaeological or kind of anatomical thing that I got into. And I guess what you're seeing is, I think there's politics behind this image, but I'm not really interested in that. It's like, what you're seeing is a man being opened up, and the curiosity in the other guy's face is, I think, is what the most fascinating thing is. And because they're basically seeing themselves in a way that they've never seen it before. And that's the kind of, I don't know, truly magical thing that we have. Like the world all of us like shifted for them right before their eyes in a matter of seconds. And just in seeing something that they know so well in a way that they've never seen it before. And all through just like cutting, it's not like an additive process. It's like revealing it in a way, or cutting, digging it up. But all these images were taken out of this self-defense book, which I think were kind of, at the same time, kind of anatomical studies. And some of the works kind of mimic this anatomical models that you may have seen before, where all the parts like open up. It's the same piece, I guess, if it's not clear. And then the materials inside is just trash and stuff. I liked using just found statues because they come with the history of sculpture, or at least some aspect of it. And they were interesting to me, too, because of the shift in material in them. I think that, like, why do these statues exist today? I would get the first ones like in Chelsea and New York, that's only like a block away from like the center of the art market. They are sculptures, and by that you think that they're art, but they're not participating in this conversation whatsoever. And so for me, it was kind of interesting to gather them and bring them into it. And A, they're interesting before I even touch them, because they're kind of replications of these famous statues that were at one point made out of marble, or these like kind of monolithic materials that I think represented a time when we viewed the human figure as like a monolithic entity in a way, whether it was through religion or it was like, well, I guess to make it clear is like now they're made out of fiberglass or plaster. They're typically hollow. These are like materials that may not last as long, but what they do is they give us I feel like the need to remake these things is a desire to keep the past alive, and what the materials that we remake them in seems somewhat irrelevant, and I think it reduces the sculpture to an image because it reminds us of what was. But I don't know, for me with the architecture background, like what it's made from should carry the meaning as well. Kind of butchered that, but hopefully it made sense. I'm just gonna blast through some of this stuff. It's like famous Bernini Apollo and Daphne sculpture from the 1600s that has this kind of quality of a figure transforming into nature. There's these other ones that kind of have come up. It's electroformed copper on a found statue, and it goes along the same as those, like the urethane one that looks like kind of an orange icicle. This is like, the sculpture is basically grown, and so you can put this conductive paint on anything and then it will plate, and it kind of goes against the entire industry that has developed this technology. because I'll leave it in there for months at a time, and it will just grow, and the way in which it grows becomes a kind of diagram for how the electricity is moving through the object. So you'll get a bunch of growth at the top and the bottom, and it for me, it's just that half organic, half human form that I like seeing so much. This goes back, this was Thoreau's cabin, this was a Thomas Cole painting, and it's just the pioneers, it's a natural kind of romantic life, it's about freedom and self-sufficiency, where you're like your own master, gathering your food, sustaining your family. I think that's part of our culture and our kind of desire. Thoreau did that. He was kind of corny in the way he did it. He did it for like 2 years, and I think he did it for like an audience, like, I'm doing this to tell people my experience, like, and then, so there's one I made that was kind of a cabin that was made out of these kind of burned looking logs, but it was cast coal slag. This is the Unabomber's cabin. He's someone who a few people have related to Thoreau before in terms of the cabin in the wood, the kind of Luddite anti-technology, but this guy was an extremist, like willing to kill for his kind of ideology. He lived out there for, I think, 20 years before he was busted by the FBI, like shitting a hole in the floor. Like he didn't really, I mean, he wrote letters, I guess, but and a manifesto, but I feel like he was doing it for him and like playing the role for the rest of his life, not like a couple of years. But the FBI auctioned off all the stuff that they found in his cabin, and so these are photos of how it was when they found it, and I ended up getting some of the stuff from the auction, and so these is like his axe and his kind of knife sheath, his recorder, his modified axe, some pipes, the ski mask. And for me, the most remarkable thing, I guess, about this stuff is that it showed up in a cardboard box, and a lot of it is, like, pretty ordinary. Like, I don't know, your mom probably has one of these in the garage. It's like a windbreaker, shoelaces, a weird hat that is pretty unique to him, but bath towels, the hoodie, scarf, it's, like, not that big a deal. But for me, like, when I opened up the box, you could feel the horror of these objects, like, coming from it. It had a stench, and it was, despite the fact that it was all kind of mundane and ordinary stuff, it was the way in which it was used that embedded this crazy meaning into it. And for me, it was a lot like, I guess, these kind of materials that we've been using, and it just went to show that, like, I don't know, as a sculptor, I spend a lot of time making stuff, and it doesn't feel meaningful sometimes unless you've put a lot of effort into it. And it was great to actually see how meaningful this stuff was that just someone used in a particular way. They didn't have to put a ton of effort into it being meaningful. But this is me wearing the clothes, and I don't know, the purpose, I guess, is just to kind of try and see the world through his eyes and try to, I don't know, just understand it maybe. Because I think it's a certain desire that maybe all of us have. Like a lot of the work I saw today is this kind of loss of faith in like an American dream and like a certain kind of culture that has risen up, that whether it's advertising or what it is, but a kind of distrust of a lot of the stuff that's going on. And I think that that's a kind of thought that has been around for a very long time. And there's people like Ted Kaczynski who were kind of fanatics about it and willing to kill to kind of bring it down. And I don't know, it's kind of interesting. This is one of the things that was made with some of his tools. Was casting a bunch of stuff at the time in the studio, just doing sand molds and getting these kind of one-off casts, and made these medieval weapons out of a combination of my tools, like his tools, and some friends' tools. And so it was kind of an attempt to triangulate me, you, and him into a kind of, into the same conversation. And then there's like tree branches in there as well to kind of hook it all together. And then this is just like how they're kind of made. The furnace, sand molds, pouring the bronze in, and then taking it out. And one of the cool things that came out of it is that, like, through the heat, it like transforms the sand and it leaves this kind of after image and this burn into the dirt. I don't know, it seemed like the burn, I guess, was a kind of physical manifestation of the kind of horror aura that comes off of these objects. It's almost like a ghost image of, I don't know, I don't put too much weight on it. It was just kind of interesting to see. And for these, I was getting this bronze from just like a metal supply place and then just melting these ingots down. And I started ordering these like bronze statues off the internet of babes and dolphins and whatnot, and then cutting those up and melting them down into kind of functional tools, you could say, or weapons, whatever you want to call them. So there's a couple of crowbars in the back, hammers, chisels, and I think part of it was, well, I don't even want to talk about it, but, and then these were made from that same metal. And in a sense, I guess it's like taking something completely useless and turning it into something useful. And I think tools are like, there's like two types of logic in a sense. One is like this natural logic that I think we can fully trust in the way that things are made according to that, whether it's the icicle or a tree or a flower or erosion or a fire and all that, like it makes perfect sense and it will never go away. And then there's kind of like a man-made logic, which is like, I think, perfected in the tool where it has, these things are crafted and made for a specific purpose. Sledgehammers, hammers, axes. It's almost been an hour, so I'm going to blast through a ton of this stuff because there's a lot more. And part of the, like, using an existing figure, it like carries that weight of the history of sculpture and or whatever, but it also, I'd use it to, like, a lot of them, I guess, like with these, pouring the kind of plastic over the top of them, the figure then draws like a new portrait of itself. And the classical figure is like a tool in a way. It was about this monolithic understanding of the human form. It was about light and how it bounced off of it. And then this plastic was more of a representation of the way that things are made in nature. And so I started using some of my own work as a kind of, I don't know what you'd call it, or I just cut it in half just so you could see the inside, whether it's like anatomical or in terms of surgery or whatever. These were some of the first, these paint ones, where I just dipped the figure in the can of paint until all the paint was more or less gone. And then they all broke. So found some other method to kind of do that same thing. This was one of the first ones called Nature Boy, like found statue, kind of cut up with this kind of coal slag form kind of growing out of it. He sliced at the eyes, and your eyes kind of create the horizon line. And I don't know, for me, it just made a connection to the landscape. And there's like hair gel. First time I used the hair gel and the chlorine down there. The arms that were cut off are down there. The foil mold that was used is kind of sticking out the back in that picture. It's weird to look at some of these and talk about them in the way that I used to talk about them. Because for me, a lot of these are figurative sculptures, but they're kind of, all the parts that make them up were kind of pulled from, I mean, everyday life, but the way in which they reference, like, life hundreds or thousands of years ago is just weird to me. Like the bust, and then there's, like, a poster of nature, and I don't know, maybe corny. Try to get to some of the newer stuff. I think that the interest in kind of making figurative sculptures led me to this interest in gymnasiums or just kind of weightlifting, because these objects, like the universal gym, is a kind of figurative sculpture in that every part of the human body is kind of represented. You have your chest, you have your legs, you have whatever, arms and whatnot. And there was something, I don't know, to that. And then made these cat litter weights to kind of earth, I don't know, turn it into a kind of earth mover. This is called the Ebstorf map. I think it's like a medieval map of the world. And the beauty of these things is that what they would try to do, I think, when these were made, is that they would try to map everything that they knew at that particular moment in time. And it wasn't so much about geographic accuracy, but it was about the kind of mythology at the time, the architecture of the time, and just like everything that they knew and everything that they believed. And I thought this could be like a good exercise for, I don't know, me to do. This was one of the first ones, and it's all like cast objects that we made in the studio, ranging from what I think is maybe the oldest tool to maybe the newest tool. So all arranged according to kind of logic of taxonomy, which is where you just kind of put like things next to like things based on their shape. So there's like a cast taken from, I don't know how old it is, but a kind of caveman hand axe from, I don't know, maybe 1400 years ago. I don't remember now, but it's like in the lower right. And then there's bones, skulls, there's like swords and stuff that I got at Toys R Us. It kind of operated like a clock in a sense, but where time is suspended, where all these objects can kind of exist independent of their kind of historical context. This was one more based on my life, where it was just all the kind of things that, I don't know, objects in my life almost, and some land masses to kind of give it that connection to the maps. I think the rock stacks were, again, that kind of rationalization of nature. The first ones that were done were, I have these friends who seem to always be outside doing cool shit while I was like stuck in the studio. And I kind of admired their life, like they're doing what I feel like I should have been doing. And so the first ones that were made, I asked them to give me a t-shirt or some article of clothing, and they each gave me one. I think this was the first three, like Maya, Peter, and Andrew, and they were just named after them. This one was me. think I showed some of these. Sorry. One of the things that came out of that kind of interest in these artificial materials was that I felt like I was kind of fueling the fire I might want to be putting out. And so I'd go to the grocery store and spend like hundreds of dollars on cat litter and like chlorine or hair gel and all this shit that I don't really care about, and thought I should probably try to make stuff out of raw material. And so some of the first that came out of this was I wanted to do the tree carving painting out of real bark, and so was able to kind of figure that out and get these chunks of real bark and laminate them flat. And the plan originally was to like have people come and carve into them, but when they showed up they already had this kind of mark making at play. And the marks for me, like, I don't know if like a tree when it grows outside, moss will only grow on the north side of a tree because the south side is hit by the sun. It absorbs the moisture and keeps kind of any kind of, I don't know, gross like moss from developing. And so they became these kind of, they seemed to kind of pinpoint, they had this like language of mark making, which is like a painter thing. And then they also kind of pinpointed a specific place, like almost on the planet, just in terms of the type of wood and then the orientation of the tree and all of that. So you can see that white streak is the south side of the tree. Let's see. Maybe I'll talk about these and then we can like finish up. But this was a model of a house in Philadelphia called at the address of 6221 Osage Avenue. And it was a house that this kind of return to nature Black liberation group lived at. I think it was like early 80s. They had two run-ins with the police at two different addresses. And this was the and a kind of exact replica of the house during the second interaction. And for me, it's like, this was a part of a show that was basically all about like assimilation and evacuation. And it was basically a group of people living their lives in this house, and other people didn't really like the way they lived. So the police made repeated attempts to kick them out. And what ended up happening in the end is that they dropped a backpack full of explosives onto the roof. There's a whole documentary about this incident called Let It Burn. The explosive caught this little tank of gas on fire. The whole place started to go up in flames. And there were fire trucks on hand to kind of, you know, in anticipation of something like this. And one of the guys in charge just said let it burn instead of putting it out, and ended up killing, I think, I can't remember now, 7 or 12 people. It was either 7 adults, 5 children, something like that, all just because, I don't know, people didn't really approve of their lifestyle. And for me to build it as a model, it ended up burning down like 2 huge city blocks as well, so tons of people lost their homes. But it was built at a scale that when you kind of walked around it, you occupied the kind of, I don't know, I called it the executioner's gaze. So you were, it was as if you were in the helicopter looking down on this thing. And like the gaze is something that comes up in art sometimes, whether it's the male gaze or the cameras or whatever it is. And for me, the kind of executioner's gaze was seemed to kind of come up again and again in this kind of group of work. So for the same show, we made a record, like an album, and it was all the music that the FBI had blasted at the Branch Davidian compound in Waco, Texas, back in the day. And so for me, they had kind of inadvertently created this soundtrack for evacuation, but I thought that picture was coming up soon, but these were also in that show. And what I'd heard this quote that was something like, when the white man came, we had the land and they had the Bible. They gave us the Bible and told us to close our eyes and pray. When we opened our eyes, they had the land and we had the Bible, something like that. And for me, it was just like, I had a couple of these kind of cigar store Indians in the studio at the time. I'd come across this quote, had been wondering what to do with these things, and it just seemed to be a kind of perfect, I don't know, recipe for what I had been looking for. And so on each of these Indians is carved a kind of notorious, you could say, Indian killer, where these are, again, like kind of about assimilation, where you kind of become what you hate, whether you like it or not. It's like join us or die mentality that, as I think, has been a kind of part of American culture since the very beginning. I think that's Buffalo Bill, Lyndon Johnson, who, I don't know, set out to kind of help them, but I think it ended up backfiring. George Washington, just because he's a symbol for what America is today. Andrew Jackson, notorious. This was the record. And the Branch Davidians were trying, this was like 93 maybe, and they were trying to make this connection to the way that the police treated Rodney King, to the way that they were being treated, which was, I don't know, I don't really back anything that David Koresh was doing, but it was interesting at that time to see how they were using music as a form of torture. All right, this is pretty much it. The end, guys. You got any questions? Let's go to dinner.